to our internet listeners, we're going to keep reminding you, if you haven't already, please go down and subscribe to this cast so that when we come up, you'll be notified. That way you won't miss us. And also share with your family and your friends, your Sunday school classes, that we are here so they too can join in and be blessed by the Word of God here at World Class Sunday School. Somebody tell me what's wrong with the people today. Somebody tell me what's wrong with the people today. Seems like the brother of love faded away. We'd like to welcome you to World Class Sunday School again. It's always a pleasure to have you join us as we continue to read and study the Word of God. Pray with me, please. Lord, today we are thankful to you again for allowing us this opportunity to share in your Word. We pray that our hearts and minds are open to what you are saying or teaching us, that we have a desire to do the things that we learn to do, the things that are pleasing in your sight. We love, praise you, and magnify you. It's in Jesus' name we pray and give you thanks always. Amen. We're continuing in our spring quarter, God Frees and Redeems. And in our third unit is entitled Liberating Letters. And on our last session, our lesson was coming from Paul's letter to the churches at Galatia. And we are continuing in that book of the Bible. And today our lesson is coming from the fifth chapter of Galatians. And we talked about Paul's letter to the Christians at Galatia, included those churches in Iconium, Lystra, and Derbe. These churches were established by Paul on his first missionary journey. This letter was to those churches and Christians everywhere. And the purpose was to refute the Judaizers, false teachers who taught that Gentile believers must obey the Jewish law in order to be saved, especially those concerning or regarding circumcision. We also talked about how Paul expressed his great concern that they are allowing themselves to be turned aside from the faith of the gospel. He encouraged them to maintain the gospel doctrine of justification by faith in Jesus Christ without the works of the law. And he establishing this important doctrine, he challenged them to stand fast in the liberty which Jesus Christ had made them free through faith and through his sacrificial death on the cross. And he cautioned them not to abuse this liberty that they had. Today's lesson is coming from Galatians, the fifth chapter, and we're going to look at verses 1 through 15. It's entitled Freedom, Love, and Faith. And we have four outlines that we're going to follow. The first outline is Fight for Freedom, Galatians, the fifth chapter, verse 1. The second outline is Searching for Freedom, the fifth chapter of Galatians, verses 2 through 6. The third outline is Obstacles to Freedom, Galatians 5th chapter, verses 7 through 12. And then the fourth outline is The Paradox of Freedom, Galatians 5th chapter, verses 13 through 15. So this is a very exciting lesson, and we have 15 verses, and we're going to just jump right in and begin in our first outline, which is entitled Fight for Freedom, in Galatians 5 and 1. And it's talking about accomplished by Christ. I'm going to read the A part of verse 1. It says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberties wherewith Christ has made us free. And now we're talking about fighting for freedom. Now, we literally don't have to fight because Christ has done it all. So our position here is just believe in what Christ has done to make us free. Christ has done all that needs to be done. And we don't have to put on our boxing gloves. We don't have to draw our weapons. Our position here is to put our faith in what Christ has done. We have been set free from the bondage of sin. Our freedom comes at a great cost because Christ had to give his life to free all that believe in him. Then the B portion of verse 1 is talking about abandoning the yoke. And it says, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. And here what Paul is saying is that Christ has won our freedom by making the sacrifice to give his life on the cross to set us free from the bondage of sin. And Paul is encouraging his readers here not to go back into to the yoke of being in bondage by sin. Christ has set us free. We have been freed from sin because of Jesus Christ's sacrifice on the cross. We've been freed from all man-made rules. And here he was referring to the teaching of the Judaizers, who was teaching that in order for the Gentiles to become true believers, they had to have faith along with adhering to the work of the law. But Christ has made us free from sin. He's made us free from man-made rules. And he's made us free from fear. And he's made us free from guilt. Christ has done all that for us. This is God's plan for those of us who are his children, those who believe and accept what Christ has done on the cross. That brings us to the second outline of our lesson. And here we're going to see searching for freedom. Searching for freedom. And that's Galatians, the 5th chapter, verses 2 through 6. And the first portion here of searching for freedom, we're going to look, it's looking to the law. And verse 2 says, behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if you be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Christ is become of no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. Okay, so searching for freedom, looking into the law, is what we see here in our second outline. And Paul is saying that the Judaizers were teaching that the gospel was incomplete without the Jewish law, and that circumcision was a requirement to complete their salvation. Now, we know what circumcised, how that came into the picture. God instructed Abraham to be circumcised, and all the male was circumcised, and this identified them as being the descendants of Abraham. Now that Christ has come, it's no more circumcision. Circumcision is not required anymore. When we have faith in Jesus, Then we become Abraham's spiritual seeds. We talked a little about that in our last session. But because of our faith in Jesus Christ, we become Abraham's spiritual seeds. But now the Judaizers are telling the Galatians that in order for them to be in God's family, in order for them to have salvation, that they must adhere to the law of circumcision. Okay, and Paul is saying that this very act, and he's talking about the act of being circumcised, he said this very act would make Christ's sacrificial death of no benefit. And what he's saying, if circumcision is still is required, then why would Jesus have to die on the cross in order for us to be reconciled with God if we could do it by keeping the law? And so searching for freedom and looking to the law is not gonna get us the freedom from sin that we're talking about here. And he says, for I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Paul says in Romans 10 chapter verse 5, he says, a man which doeth those things, that means live by the law, he shall live by them. What that indicates is, if you're going to live by the law, you have to keep each every law. If you break one law, you've broken them all. That's what he's saying. And he's showing us that we were unable to live without breaking any laws. He says, if we adhere to what they are teaching, these false teachers, if we adhere to that, then Christ has become of no effect unto you. And whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. And here in this fourth chapter, we're talking about how Paul is showing them that it's not by the law that salvation comes, but it's by faith in Christ. And this is the grace of God that we're talking about. And if you would read Ephesians 2 and 8, it says, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And you cannot earn a gift. A gift is something that's freely given. And God gives his freedom to us because of our faith in his son, Jesus Christ. It's a free gift. It's not by any works that we do. And then he says, but if Christ become of no effect, if you're going to adhere to the law, he says, then whosoever you are justified by the law, you are fallen from grace. Now here, falling from grace does not mean losing salvation. It's turning away from grace. It's turning from the way to salvation. When you turn away from grace, you turn away from the way to salvation. It's like an astronaut cutting his lifeline to the mothership. Now, you know, when an astronaut is walking in space, the only way he can get back to the mothership is by the lifeline that's connected. Now, if he cuts that, then he has no way to get back to the mothership. Or like a person taking off his life preserver when he's lost at sea. When you fall from grace, it means that you're turning away from the way to salvation, and then there's no other way. So when you look at the law, searching for freedom, when you look at the law, we know that the law had no power to save us. Now here in beginning in verse 5, we're going to look to love. We're looking to love. Verses 5 and 6. It says, "For we through the Spirit wait for hope of righteousness by faith. For in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love." And Paul is just laying it out here so plain, and he's showing us that the law had its purpose, but the law was unable to bring salvation to us. And here he's showing us that through faith in Jesus Christ, we are made righteous. We are put back in the right fellowship with God, not because of anything that we've done, not because of keeping the law, but it's because of faith in Jesus Christ. And so because of that faith that we have in Christ, he says, through the Spirit, we wait for hope of the righteousness by faith. We don't work for righteousness. We wait for God to grow his righteousness in us through the Holy Spirit, not through anything we do. And how is it? When we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, then salvation comes instantly. Then we go through the process. Righteousness is imputed to us, but we progress by reading God's word, by our active prayer life, all those things we do in order to grow in maturity. And we have hope, and the hope of righteousness by faith is put in Jesus Christ. And the hope in believing that one day we're gonna be made whole or holy. The promise that Christ has made when he returned. But until that time, then we are working to mature. And so we have to do those things that's going to help us grow in our walk with Christ. Then he says, "For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything or not uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love." And circumcision, whether you're circumcised or not, availeth nothing regarding God's righteousness. It has nothing to do with it. Nothing at all. Circumcision has nothing at all to do. And what matters is our faith that's expressed through love for God and for one another. That's what matters. And that's why we're looking to love for the salvation and not to the law. Okay, and then our third outline, it talks about the obstacles to freedom. Okay, so we can't find this freedom in the law, but we can find it in love. And it's demonstrated when we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, then it's demonstrated through love, our love for God and our love for one another. And now, because we have been imputed righteousness, we are free because of what Christ has done, then there are obstacles that we're going to face. Now we're going to look at that. It's here, found here, the obstacles to freedom, Galatians, the 5th chapter, verses 7 through 12. And first we're going to look at persuasion. That's verses 7 through 10. So verse 7 says, "Ye did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth?" Okay, and so what Paul is saying here, when he's talking about persuasion, he's talking about Galatian believers, and then he used an analogy of a foot race. He says that you ran well, you started out well. In their walk with Christ, they believed the truth and they were obeying the word of God. But then he said, who hindered you? He's referring to the false teachers or the Judaizers. Someone cut in on them, the Judaizers or the false teachers, obstructing their obedience. And then he says, this persuasion come not from him that called you. He says that this hindrance or this obstacle or this persuasion didn't come from God. Paul called it another gospel. And he said, it's not from God. And then verse 9 says, a little leaven the whole lump. And what he's talking about is when you put any amount of yeast in a loaf of bread, it's gonna affect the whole loaf. And he's saying that this false teaching that they are getting is affecting their whole walk with Christ. And then verse 10, he said, I have confidence in you, though, through the Lord, that ye will be none otherwise minded. But he that troubleth you shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. Okay, and what he's saying here in verse 10, he has confidence in them that they will get back in the race, that they would return to obeying the truth, and that their minds would be focused on God's word. And you know, sometimes we stray off the path. Especially when we're not reading and studying God's word, when we're not praying like we should, we falter and we get off. But like Paul here, we should have the confidence that we're going to get back on track when we make up our minds to focus on God's word. And he said God is going to deal with those false teachers, those who put the obstacles in your way, and God is going to deal with them. So we don't have to worry about those persuaders. God is going to deal with them. And then verses 11 through 12, 11, we're talking about persecution. Paul says, and I, brethren, if I yet preach circumcision, why do I yet suffer persecution? Now, the Judaizers was saying that Paul was wishy-washy on the subject of circumcision. And Paul's reply was, he said, I'm not preaching or promoting circumcision as a way to salvation. He said, if I was preaching the same message that you're preaching, then why are you persecuting me? He says, if he was preaching what they were preaching, no one would be offended. He said, they were even cut off, which troubled you. And here in verse 12, he says, if he preached what they were preaching, no one would be offended. And the cross was a stumbling block to the Jews and the Judaizers. He called them agitators here in verse 12, talking about the Judaizers and the false teachers. Paul was rejected because of his stand with Christ. And we're rejected, and the world rejects us because of our stand with Christ. And since Jesus' death and resurrection, circumcision had no spiritual value. And that's what Paul was enlightening them here. Okay, so and now we got to move to the fourth outline is entitled Paradox of Freedom. Denying the flesh. And verse 13a says, for brethren, you have been called unto liberty. And the call applies to all believers. When he says the call, he's talking about those of us who have accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And he says, only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. Because we are in Christ, we have been set free. We live in the liberty that Christ has given us. But this liberty is not used to satisfy the flesh, but it's used to love and to serve others. And then verses 14 through 15, here he's talking about fulfilling the law. And verse 14 says, "For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. But if ye bite and devour one another, take heed that ye be not consumed one of another." And here Paul is putting in perspective fulfilling the law. And he used one word, and that's love. And he's talking about Matthew's the 22nd chapter, when the lawyer asks Christ, "What is the most important commandment?" And Christ says, "The first commandment was, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, and strength. And the second commandment is like unto you, love your neighbor as yourself." And here he's talking about loving the Lord thy God and loving one another. Here the law is reduced to its greatest commandment. And then he gives a warning. And this is a warning to the church. "Let us not bite and devour one another. Let the spirit of love flow like a river. That will please God. The world will know that we are Christians by our love one for another." Lord, we thank you for this time. Thank you for your word that's just so plain and clear to us. And we just thank you, Lord, that you have freed us from sin and its consequences. And we just thank Jesus Christ for giving his life so that we might live to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray and give you thanks and praises always. Well, again, friends, we thank you for joining us on today, and we look forward to having you in our next session. So until then, may God richly bless and keep you, is our prayer. Somebody.